Okay, so moving on to our next topic, that is ERP and CRM. Okay, so first of all, what is this ERP system, sir? See, previously we used to have accounting softwares. Like Tally used to be an accounting software in the good old back days. And what is the difference between an accounting software and an ERP, sir? Technically, an accounting software will only cater to the accounting needs. It records the journal entries, it prepares the ledger balances, trial balance, P&L, balance sheet, cash flow statement. It only gives you the accounting records. Whereas an ERP system is a comprehensive system. It covers inventory management. It covers payroll processing. It covers your taxation. It covers your GST. It covers your income tax. It covers your TDS, TCS. It covers your attendance of your employees. It covers their salary processing, payrolls, payslips, and your inventory requirements, reorder levels, purchase order processing, sales order processings. Everything related to your organization is comprehensively sorted in one place that is called as an ERP, Enterprise Resource Planning. It plans for all the resources in your organization in one place at one point of time. That is called as an ERP, guys. Okay, you have SAP, you have Oracle, you have Tally, you have QuickBooks, you have Sage. There are different types of ERPs in the market. Okay, which suits for your organization, that is something that you need to decide for yourself. Then what is a CRM, sir? Customer Relationship Management. See, CRM is a very, 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 very huge topic, actually. It's not something that is coverable in 5 paragraphs or 10 paragraphs. CRM is a very big software. So what CRM systems does is, it covers everything related to a customer. Point number one, the first initial phase where the customer is entering into our organization. When did he enter? What did he purchase? Why did he purchase? How much did he purchase? How did he make the payment? Is it credit card payment, UPI payment, Google Pay, Phone Pay? What is his contact number? What product is he purchasing on a repetitive basis? How frequently is he purchasing? All this analysis are done by CRM. Is he raising any complaints? Is that complaint resolved or not? Every single interaction that you do with your customer is covered in the CRM, customer relationship. Entire relationship with a given customer is sorted by the CRM systems. Look, it is built and it is an approach to build and sustain a long-term business with your customers. The process that the company uses to track and organize the contacts with its current and prospective customers, future customers as well. CRM software used to support this process, information about the customers, their order history, their personal information, their address, their contact numbers, customer interactions, when did they enter the store, when did they leave the store, what all items did they purchase, how many quantity did they purchase, are they buying more if you give them discounts, are they buying less if you don't give them discounts, are they interested in reward points, loyalty points, are they not interested, are they paying through credit cards, every bit of information. Okay. So the main stages of developing and maintaining appropriate customer relationships. Point number one, selection, identifying who are your targeted audience. Sir, I cannot, you know, if you ask me to teach a 7th standard kid, I'll be an utter failure. I'll be like, God bless your soul, beta. Good luck with your future. Tata, bye bye. I'll come out from there. I don't think I'm fit to teach 7th standard students, sir. Why? Because that is not my targeted audience. And unfortunately, I'm not good enough to teach them. There are certain skill sets that are required to be possessed in order to teach certain category of people. I don't have that skill set. I cannot teach undergraduates. Even graduates only, I feel very difficult to teach sometimes, unfortunately. That's how it is. I'm not saying that they are not good enough for me. I'm saying that I am not good enough to teach them, as simple as that. It's very simple logic here. There are special skill sets that are required. So whether you are dealing with the product or whether you are dealing with the service, you should know your audience. You should know who you are targeting towards. You know, if you ask me to teach, ignore 7th standard, ma. If you ask me to teach F1, F2, F3, F4, na, I know I can teach that. I'll be very, it becomes very easy to teach me, easy for me to teach those papers. But the problem is that I don't think I can do justice to the student in that particular papers, because those are very fundamental papers. If I give too much knowledge at the fundamental level, now people will not be able to capture what is actually important for them. That is the reason I don't teach those papers anymore. Initially, at the starting stage of my career, I did teach F2, F3 also, but not anymore. What happens is I tend to give too much information at the basic level. So that's how it is. So I'm not touching those papers anymore. I'm sticking to these things. Even skills level also, I think I give too much information at skills level also. So professional level papers are my forte. That is where we can unlock the true potential of the subject and we can go into the depth of it. Yeah, anyways, that's okay. Let's go further. No, let's not dilute the subject here. So first, selecting the proper target audience is the first phase of your CRM. And then acquiring those audience. Sir, I understood that. Okay, these are the people I should target. Then out of these targeted people, how many will you acquire to be your customer? And then after acquiring a customer, how many of them can you retain in the longer span of time? You know, fortunately or unfortunately, our retention, my student retention ratio is much higher than 75%. 3 out of every 4 students continue to the next paper. Very few people, unfortunately, they had to drop out because of various reasons. So what happens is, I'll tell you the reasons also. Point number one is that they come to ACCA without knowing the intensity of the course. Why, sir? Because college is giving 5 papers exemption, na? 6 papers exemption, not 5. College is giving 6 papers exemption. So we'll start with 7th paper. They take it for granted and start with 7th paper. And then they'll come to understand that, okay, this is not our cup of tea. This is not as easy as our rest of the college papers. And then they drop out. There are certain category of people who do that. Then there are certain category of students, unfortunately, who are not at a position where they can pay the tuition fee. They can pay the exam fee. They can pay the subscription fees. It's just too costly for them. So there are certain people who drop out because of the financial factors. Unfortunately, we try to provide some kind of assistance, but at least I will not be able to pay their exam fees, right? So something I can do, the tuition fee, I'll do that. But exam fees is something that we cannot do. So that is another reason. But honestly with you guys, I'll tell you, till date, we did not have a single dropout because the quality of the content is not up to the mark. We don't have even a single student who said that. At least we do take anonymous feedback also. Till date, we never got any negative feedback. So that's a good thing. Touch wood, we should continue like that. Anyways, let's move further. So retention, once you attain a customer, you should retain them. Let's not leave our customers or let's not drop our customers. Sir, business people call it as customers. I will never call my students customers, okay? Next, extension of the existing customer base. So you have thousands of customers. Convert that into lakhs. So build better relationships with your customers. They'll refer more and more customers to your organization. Customer satisfaction is the end of discussion. Success result for any company, as simple as that. Then after sales service is also very important. Just because you sold and ignored doesn't mean you will become successful. You have to stay in contact with your customers. You have to get their feedbacks. You have to monitor your success rates. You have to monitor your performance rates. Then only you'll be in a successful position. Else, God bless your soul. You may have initially good sales, but if your customers are not satisfied, then obviously you will see the worst. We have seen organizations flourishing from 0 to 100 in a short span of time and then dropping from 100 to 0 in such short span of time. So it all depends on how you treat your customers and how you provide your after sales services. Collect the sales figure, whatever sales, whatever goods you are selling them or services that you are providing them, give the goods and services, collect the consideration and then ignore them. You will never become successful, right? For example, Micromax is an amazing mobile brand phone back in the days. I'm talking about back in the days. They launched this series called Canvas. I don't know how many of you know it, but Microsoft has a series called Canvas. That series was so good. That was so good, to be very honest. It was so much value for money. But you have 0 Micromax sales today. Why, sir? Just because of after sales services. It's after sales services are pathetic. There was no service centers only, to be very honest, that are functional. Even if you find a service center and go there, they don't have spare parts. It will take 15, 20, 30 days to get your mobile back. So because of pathetic after sales services only, they have gone out of the market. Okay. So CRM deals with all of these things. Now moving on to our next topic, that is big data. So the name itself is very self-explanatory. Big amount of data is called as big data. So that's all. Yes, that's all, ma'am. So big data doesn't talk about specific information. Big data doesn't focus on cost benefit analysis related data. Gather only that much data which gives you benefit. No, big data, gather everything. Gather everything. Whatever data is available, gather that and store it. Sir, why, sir? You never know when it is going to become useful for you. Okay. See, look at this. The most commonly used referring to large volumes of data beyond the normal processing, storage, and analysis capacity of typical database tools. The big data cannot work on Excel because Excel has a limited number of rows and columns. You know how many rows you have? 10,48,576. Yes, you can add more rows, but sir, what happens with Excel is that after a point of time, it cannot process data. I have faced situations where Excel gets hung because of too much data to process. It literally hangs for like 5 minutes and then it starts recollecting and then it starts processing. We do scenario analysis and all that stuff. Now it becomes very problematic for Excel to handle huge volume of data. So big data is talking, we are not even talking about lakhs, we are talking about crores and crores of data points. Okay. So normal database application tools cannot handle that. You have separate tools like Hadoop or else Python. Yeah, Python. So there are separate tools which handle with big data. Okay. Big data does not refer to any specific quantity. The term is often used when speaking about petabytes, not even terabytes. We are not talking about MB, GB or TB. We are talking about petabytes of information and exabytes of information. That's like 100 hard disks. Sir, your Excel file is 1 MB, 2 MB, 10 MB maximum. If you use macros, your Excel file will be 10 MB. 1 GB can store 1,000 files of that. 1 TB can store 100,000 files, 1,000 thousands. Imagine hundreds of hard disks of that information. 1,000 TB is equal to petabyte. Yes, 1,000. It's actually 1024. It's 2 power 10. Anyways, that's fine. 1024, it is accurately speaking. Good. Now imagine, sir, big data is that huge volume that we are talking about. It's not small files or 10 files or 100 files or 1,000 files. We are talking about petabytes of information. Okay. See, different sources, government documentation, GPS point tracking, web pages, contents of web pages. So if you talk about Google, imagine the storage of data that Google has. That is called big data, my dear friends, not your Excel sheets and spreadsheets. I'm talking about millions of data points, billions of data points. Okay. Now, big data has three characteristics. What are those, sir? Velocity, volume, and variety, also called as veracity. Now, what are these three V's, sir? Velocity. Update the data as fast as possible. Every time there has to be virtually new data coming up. Every time there is a new update, it has to be stored into the data. The velocity, the speed with which the data is being stored should be very fast. It should be real-time analysis. Okay. Next, volume of data. It cannot be small data files. It has to be a huge volume of data. And then variety of information. I cannot just focus on one part of the data and say that I'm having big data. No, you should have huge variety of data. Okay. See, rich text files, audio files, GPS data points, all that stuff has to be there on the big data servers. I'll tell you a simple example of how big data works. There is this case study which we do in APM. Yeah, APM, Advanced Performance Management. In my regular lectures, I explain this case study. So how Data Analytica, there is a company called Data Analytica. So this company has literally because of this company, our very own comedian, our biggest friend, our biggest enemy, you can call him however you want, our very own Donald Trump. The success of Donald Trump was completely because of Data Analytica. Okay, because of how much data points they gathered. They were able to know what is the favorite color of every single individual in that particular voting capacity. They were actually able to understand that. And targeted advertisement was done based on the data that has been collected. They told us, the Data Analytica, the company came out and told that on every citizen of US, they had almost all 150 to 200 data points. Every single citizen, they had 100 plus up to 200 data points. What is your name? What is your first name, last name, middle name, age, date of birth? What is your favorite color? What is your favorite sport? What is your favorite place? Like this, they had 150 to 200 data points on every citizen of the country. That is big data that we are talking about. And they have literally changed the way the elections are conducted and the results we all know. So really, do you think Donald Trump deserves to be the president of US? Is he a POTUS material left to your imagination. Okay, that's how big data can work. Ma, they gave you example of Facebook in this particular sense. You can read that later. Data Analytica is a case study. You can read that later when you have a, you know, free time or whatever it is. Chalo, they're talking about different sources, social networks, web servers, traffic log monitors, satellite imageries, audio content which is being streamed, banking transactions. All of these are different sources of big data. Benefits, sir. Information is the key. That's all. Information is the new oil. Sir, actually, information is not the new oil. Information is much better than oil. Oil is only limited. Information is unlimited. Oil has an expiry. Information does not have expiry. Oil needs huge volumes of storage. Like basically, like, you know, there is storage cost involved. Data also has storage cost involved, but not as much as oil. There is no theft of, there is no risk of fire or something like that. There are backups for data. So data and information is not the new oil. It is better than the oil. Anyways, it increases your productivity, gives you competitive advantage. All that stuff will be there. Now, what are the risks associated with big data? So first of all, skills. We should have people. We should have systems that can deal with big data. That's the biggest problem. Your normal systems cannot deal with big data. Your normal people cannot understand the analysis part of that. There has to be skill set that is required. Security is very important. That huge volumes of data need to be securely maintained. And then data protection is also very important. So recently, Upstox had a data breach. Imagine Upstox having a data breach. How many of you know Upstox? Upstox. Do you guys know Upstox or not, ma? Swarna knows. Good. What about others? UPSTOX through advertisements. Okay. So basically, Upstox is one discount broker. I can call them as a discount brokers. So what they do is it's like stock market brokers. So you create an account with them, and through that particular account, you can purchase the stocks of different companies and you can sell them, including derivative transactions, futures, forwards, not forwards. Sorry, forwards are not openly traded. Your shares, options, call options, put options, futures. Then they have an MCX segment as well, where you can purchase commodities like gold, silver, and crude oil. Then they have a forex markets as well. So yeah, basically it's stock market related. Imagine a stockbroker data getting leaked. Upstox data got leaked. Unfortunately, I'm also having an Upstox account, but I don't use it much. I more use Zerodha than Upstox because Zerodha is more user interactive than Upstox. Upstox do have more features compared to Zerodha, but it's more easier on Zerodha than Upstox to do a quick trade. There are certain trades which I do in less than 1 minute, like purchase and sell in less than a minute. So Zerodha is much easier to do that rather than Upstox. Anyways, let's not go into that. I'm not here to promote any company for that matter. I don't get any commissions or anything from them. Let's move further. So management of big data and data analytics, all this stuff I have already covered. So that's the end of this chapter, guys. Chapter number 4, 3 is also done. Okay, any doubts in chapter number 2 and 3? Boring topics, interesting. Thank you. No doubts, I guess then. Chalo, we still have 20 minutes in the day left. So I don't want to close the session and leave 20 minutes because, as I told you, by 29th, I have to confirmly finish this batch at any cost, because 30, I'll not be in Hyderabad and I don't want May to, have any lectures. May should be for your preparation. By 29th, I'll have to finish your entire syllabus, and I'm not doing a revision. I'm actually explaining the contents for you. Methodology to read these two chapters. Ma, very simple methodology. That is, take the headings. Okay, once we are done with this chapter, go through the textbook once. While going through this textbook, what you will do is note down the subheadings of each topic, prepare some charts kind of a thing, like information systems, three types. What are those three types? So you have three levels in the management. So for each level, which is the suitable system, information system for strategic level? So EIS systems are useful. For tactical level, MIS systems and DSS systems are useful. Then for operational level, you will need the TSS systems, TPS systems, transaction processing systems. So what are the characteristics? Like, make some pictorial representation and side headings. Important advantages and disadvantages. What are the costs of implementing new systems? Prepare some summaries and read those summaries before the exam. That's all. Don't spend too much time understanding and by hearting these points. Not required for ACC exams. Okay. Not like CA exams. They won't ask you to write the characteristics of ABC systems like that. No, you are not required to by heart anything at ACC level. You just need to have a super view of all this stuff and you can dump it down in the exam. Mind maps. Yes, that's what. Mind maps. Okay. Cool. Good. Chalo. So we still have 15 minutes left. It's 11:45. So what I'll do is I cannot start any of the fifth chapter. My CVP analysis is a very important chapter. I cannot play around with that. So what I'll do is I'll go to one of the smallest chapters, chapter number 11, quantitative analysis. This is a very simple topic. There are only two topics in that. One is high-low analysis and the other one is learning curve analysis. So we'll do high-low now. High-low takes 5 minutes only. If you solve one problem, it will take 10 minutes. So that's all. Then we'll move on to the learning curve analysis tomorrow. Learning curve will take another 15-20 minutes because of the log factors involved in that. So I'll have to explain how logarithms work as well. Not the statistical part of it, but in the Excel, how to do the calculations. That's a very small topic. You can see here, it's 26 pages. Remove one page in the introduction, one page in the ending. So 23 pages. It's very small topic. We'll go with quantitative analysis. Okay. High-low analysis we'll start with. Is that fine, guys? Okay. Very small topic, ma. You don't need to worry about, sir, already two chapters we finished. Nothing like that. Very small topic it is. Look at what we are going to learn in this particular chapter, ma. First one, explaining and evaluating the use of high-low analysis to separate the fixed and variable elements of the total cost. Explain the use of judgment and experience in forecasting. Then learning curve effect, learning effect, budgetary problems. Then problems with learning curve, limitations of learning curve. So basically two topics only, high-low analysis, learning curve. Only these two topics are covered in this particular chapter. So first we'll do the high-low analysis, then we'll go on to the learning curve model. Okay. It's very, very simple, ma. Very, very basic topic. You can see here, high-low analysis, only this much. Only this much is the high-low. Then they gave you one problem, then example. That's all. Okay. Very small topic. So let's start with high-low. I think I'll need to use the notes for this. So let me just very quickly go to that. Okay, sir, what is this quantitative analysis all about, sir? So please understand, first, in this quantitative analysis, we are going to deal with quantities, obviously, name suggests. Okay, we are going to deal with the two topics, ma. What are those, sir? First one is high-low and the other one is learning curve. Both deal with quantities only. That's why this chapter is called as quantitative analysis. Sir, what do you mean by both deal with quantity? So first understand high-low, then we'll move on to the learning curve. So high-low, what it is basically, it is a technique. It is a technique that is used to split the total costs into variable cost and fixed cost. Sir, what is it? It is a technique which is used to split your total cost into variable cost and fixed cost. Okay. But please understand, high-low is not correct. High-low is not correct. Learning curve is also not correct. So then why are we learning it? Because they are techniques, ma. All techniques need not be correct all the time. Okay. It's one way of doing it. It may give you correct answers. It may not give you correct answers because these are dependent upon certain assumptions. If the assumptions are holding good, they'll give you right answers. If the assumptions are not holding good, they'll give you wrong answers. Okay. So you don't need to think that, okay, sir, is it always correct? Obviously, no. If I calculate, if I split my total cost into variable and fixed cost using high-low analysis, will I always get the accurate answer? No, you will never get the accurate answer. Very rare situations you get accurate answers. Okay, chalo. With that being said, let's understand what high-low analysis is all about. So let me take these numbers directly. Good. Okay. So we've got this information here. So different months, what are the number of units that are produced and what is the inspection cost they have given you? Now, within this, we need to calculate and figure out how much is the variance, the variable cost, and how much is the fixed cost in this particular aspects. Okay. Using high-low analysis to find the variable cost per unit and total fixed cost, forecast the total cost when 500 units are produced. Okay. Sir, step one, please understand this is very systematic. Now you just need to know some steps and that's it. So step one is that find highest and lowest activity levels. Sir, please be very careful. I'm talking about highest and lowest activity levels. So in this activity levels, tell me what is the lowest and what is the highest. 300 is the lowest. 420 is the highest. Correct? Okay. Note the costs at these levels. Cost at lowest level is 2160. Cost at highest level is 2400. Okay. Agreed. Next one. High dollar minus low dollar by high level minus low level. That's it. That's it, ma. Sir, what do you mean by that? See, in simple language for you to understand, what happened here is my lowest level of activity is 300, highest level of activity is 420. That means how many additional units did I produce in this particular span? From 300 to 420, we produced 120 units, correct? Yes or no? 420 minus 300. 120 units, okay. So for this 120 units, what is the additional cost incurred? From 2160, we incurred our cost, we increased our cost to 2400. So $2400 minus $2160. So that will be how much? $240, correct? Yes or no? Okay. So technically speaking, for 120 additional units, we incurred $240 additional dollars. So what is my variable cost per unit? Fixed cost will remain same, na? So variable cost per unit can be considered as $240 incurred for 120 units. That means $2 per unit is my variable cost. Can I consider it like that? Please say yes or no. Everybody following this? $2 per unit. How many additional units you produced? How much additional cost you incurred? Okay. Chilo. So variable cost is $2 per unit. Now, sir, I know that for 300 units cost is 2160. So total cost for 300 units. Total cost for 300 units. Can I say it as 300 into variable cost per unit plus fixed cost? Can I say it like this? 300 into variable cost per unit plus my total fixed cost. How much is the total cost? 2160. Okay. So if I substitute variable cost per unit is $2 in this, So 300 into $2 plus my fixed cost should be equal to 2160. That implies my fixed cost equal to 2160 minus 600. 300 into 2, 600 minus 600. That is 1560. Yeah? Fixed cost is $1560. Sir, we know variable cost, we know fixed cost. Please cross confirm again. Cross confirm again. Sir, how do we cross confirm? Let's calculate total cost for 420 units. So 420 into $2 each unit plus fixed cost is 1560. So 420 into 2 is 840. 840 plus 1560. 2400. Check the total cost. 2400. So perfectly matching. Cross confirm if your variable cost and fixed cost calculations are correct or wrong, ma. Okay. But please don't do it for any other level. It won't work out for other levels. It will work only for the lowest activity level and highest activity level. Please be careful regarding that. If you are taking any other level in the table, it won't work. It will not match. That's what I told you. It won't work all the times. Now, what is the question about? They're asking you for 500 units. What is the total cost? So cost for 500 units. 500 into variable cost per unit of $2. Plus fixed cost of 1560, that is 1000. 2560 is the total cost for 500 units. That is simple high-low analysis, guys. But please see, if I'm doing it for say 360 units, 360 into 2 is 720. 720 plus 1560. 720 plus 1560. 2280. That is matching. Oh, they gave nice question then. They gave you values that are actually matching in this particular case. Good. But it doesn't always work like that, ma. They gave all answers perfectly matching. That's fine. But it does not always work like that. So only do it for highest level and lowest level. Please understand, sometimes I have seen students directly taking highest rate and lowest rate from this. Please don't do that ever. Please don't do that, ma. Don't go with highest rates, I mean highest cost and lowest cost, something like that. Always first figure out highest level, lowest level, cost at highest level, cost at lowest level. Okay. See, the formula for variable cost per unit is equal to total cost at highest level, highest activity, minus total cost at lowest activity. By highest activity minus lowest activity. Okay, this is what you need to do. And once you get that variable cost per unit, you can calculate the fixed cost per unit by substituting it in any of the equations. And then you can calculate the cost, total cost for any given level of activity based on the variable cost and fixed cost. Right? Chalo, that's your high-low analysis, ma. Very simple topic. There is nothing much in that. You can do it for this also. 200, 300, 400. For 400, 9,000. For 200, 7,000. So for 200 additional unit, 2,000 is the cost. So per unit, it is $1,000. Correct? Sorry. $10. So variable cost per unit is $10. So fixed cost would be 2,000. 5,000 is the fixed cost. Done. See, $10 per unit is the variable cost per unit. Fixed cost is $5,000. Then what is our cost for 350? 350 into 10, 3,500 plus 5,000, 8,500, 8,500. Then for 600 units, 600 into 10, 6,000 plus 5,000, 11,000, 11,000. Done. Is that clear? Okay. Are there any other models to get fixed cost per unit or variable cost per unit from total cost? Yes, there are other models, ma, but not covered in your syllabus, so don't worry. There are regression analysis, then there is linear programming techniques. There are different techniques are there, but not covered for you in the syllabus. Only high-low is covered. Chalo, then we'll see you tomorrow, guys. As usual, we'll upload all the content on the batch in the app. So we'll see you there. Okay. Bye, guys. Take care.